No need to explain, Commissioner. We saw the whole sordid affair. Those criminals will be brought to justice, or I'll know the reason why. We're on our way.
Hurry, Cape Crusader. Whoever you may be under that cowl of yours, you paladin of virtue, you're our only hope.
To the Batcave.
Welcome back, citizens, to an all-new episode of the Batcave Podcast. It's your old bat chum, John S. Drew here, and here we go with issue 3 of the Batman 66 comic here in our series, and I'm joined in this review once again by the man from 13th Dimension himself, Mr. Dan Greenfield. Hey, Dan.
Hi, John.
So, you know, these nice summer months here, just sitting here reading comic books, it's kind of cool. Brings me back to my childhood.
Lounging by the pool.
Yeah, lounging by the pool, exactly. So this time around, we've got a solo villain story. It's the Joker himself in the story. Yes. The Joker sees red. I'm looking forward to this one.
Yeah, this is they like, as you pointed out, we were talking offline. They waited until the third issue, just in the same way that they waited until the third episode of the series to give us the Joker. And it is also, up till this point, we've only seen team-up episode or issue. I'm going to do this. If I interchange episode and issues throughout this entire series, just roll with it, folks, because I'm going to do it. I'm not going to keep correcting myself. Anyway, for the first three issues, we've seen all team-ups. Now we get a solo story. We start off with the cover, which is this is an interesting one by Mike and Laura Allred, where Batman is looming over Gotham City. It's a huge Batman, real big, great close-up shot of Adam West, and he's plucking the Joker out of something.
Right.
It's a much smaller version of the Joker. So Batman's got this huge hand that comes down and he's picking up the Joker. And the Joker, of course, is Cesar Romero. There is interestingly, a variant cover that basically is the opposite. It's by Cully Hamner. And in that one, the Joker's huge over the Gotham City skyline. And he's basically looming over Batman and Robin, Adam West and Burt Ward. And the story itself is the Joker sees red. We have another new artist here. It's written by Jeff Parker, art by Joe Quinones, colors by Maris Wicks, lettered by Wes Abbott, and a great one-sentence William Dozier-esque introduction. An ordinary day in Gotham City, but what's this?
Yeah, I love that. I love that. Yeah. Now, I, you know, getting to that variant cover, I love that in this. And in the story itself, the mustache is there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. All of the artists make a point of drawing the mustache, you know, under the makeup for the Joker, for Cesar Romero.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So this was a two-parter. Part one, we see a large Harlequin balloon hovering over the city. Yep. As it does, a car pulls up to a jewelry store, and a man who identifies himself as the Red Hood emerges from the car. He's wearing, you know, this cloak, and he's got a red helmet on his head. He demands that the Joker be turned over to him for vengeance as he bursts the balloon and a coughing gas erupts. Bruce and Dick are watching this on TV at Wayne Manor. They head out to Arkham Institute.
Yes.
To check in on the Joker and to see if maybe he's got some idea who this person is that wants revenge. We're introduced to Dr. Quinn.
Yes.
Who is treating patient J. I like that. The patient. Mm-hmm. No, it's like, it's not patient Joker. It's not the, it's patient J.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nice little touch there. We also see that Professor Overbeck is there. He's developed a brain regulator that they are using on Joker.
Yep.
Oh, it was nice to see. Now, Batman respects Overbeck, but he doubts that the brain regulator will work. I like that Joker plays this small prank on Batman, making him think that the still image with its back to him is really him, and then he jumps out with a boo, you know?
Right. Yep.
Yeah. He's willing to help, but only if he gets something in return. So Quinn offers him a comedy night, and Joker quickly agrees.
Of course.
That night, they go to the graveyard where they're supposed to meet up with the Red Hood. Joker runs off, though, when these gas bombs are set off. He runs right into the Red Hood's arms, where the two then disappear as a grave sinks into the ground. That's sort of an elevated grave sinking into the ground as we come to the end of part one. Now, right off the bat, I gotta say, I kind of like the fact that they do sort of, though, mix in a little bit of the modern-day Joker. Like, just the whole, he twists on a whim. Because that whole thing of, I'll give you a comedy night, and he's, like, going, sold. I can see Mark Hamill doing that line. And I'm fine with it. I don't care. I like it.
Yeah, this is the first story we have so far that really pushes the boundaries of, excuse me, the comic book world of Batman and the TV world of Batman.
Yeah.
First off, as you mentioned, this Harlequin balloon, it really, if you look, it is actually the Harley Quinn outfit. It's a Joker balloon, and the face looks like the Joker card.
Right.
But the rest of the body is basically Harley Quinn's outfit.
Yeah.
Then, of course, you get the Red Hood. The Red Hood was never on the TV show.
Nope.
It was a construct of the comic book, and it's the classic 1950s, you know, domed mask with red cape and tuxedo. You have Dr. Quinn, who is obviously Harleen Quinzel, is obviously Harley Quinn. She's wearing an A-line dress that's got a black and white checker pattern, and she's wearing little diamond earrings. She's clearly supposed to be the Harley Quinn before she's Harley Quinn. And they introduced Arkham. Now, they call it, instead of Arkham Asylum, they call it the Arkham Institute. I'm still not 100% sure why they made that change. But you have, you know, you're establishing all of these things. You're now mixing your worlds here in a way that we really haven't seen so far.
Yeah. And to me, the blending works. I have no problem with it.
Yeah. Yeah, it does. No, I mean, at this point, you know, they're 3 issues in. And they're getting more and more confident about the world that they're creating here or recreating. And this is the kind of issue I think would probably drive purists crazy.
Yeah.
But, you know, hey, look, what can I tell you? It and you're right, it does work to have Professor Overbeck and Dr. Quinn and the Red. It's good, it's tight, and I really love the artwork.
Yeah.
I really love I mean, my quibble with Joe Quinones as Batman is that you don't see his eyelids or his eyeballs. You get the white eyelids, whatever in the mask. And the same with Robin, you don't see their eyeballs. And I think that that's a mistake, but it's a small mistake. Other than that, I think it's great. And his Cesar Romero is terrific, especially the scene in the graveyard where two of his, two of the guys in the masks are holding on to the Joker, and he's got that indignant look on his face that we saw from Cesar Romero so many times, you know, when he goes, why not? You know, or one of those things. That works really well. But the art, I really like the art. I also, well, we'll get to the next half where there's a little throwaway thing that I think is a great bit too.
I also, speaking of the artwork, I love the one panel there where it's Joker with his back. It's the joke in the Institute. He's got his back to them, and we see Quinn and Batman, their reflection in the glass, looking in. I thought, wow, that is just beautiful.
Yeah. And it also is mixing. It's a very modern comic book, because the rest of the issue, it's modern comic book artwork done with a lot of old school stylings.
Right.
This one panel is just straight up modern comic books. He's using basically a different style in this one panel than he's using in the rest of the book.
Right. Now, part two, the dynamic duo follow downward into the grave to a series of tunnels that leads out of a crypt. They've lost the trail. So Joker, though, we find, is brought to one of his hideouts where he learns that the Red Hood is Professor Overbeck, who said that Joker told him to have the goons spring him. Joker's surprised by it all, but he still breaks out in laughter at how crazy the whole thing is. He wants Overbeck to make a larger version of the brain device so that he can bring everyone in line with his way of thinking. That's when the dynamic duo arrive at Joker's hideout, thanks to a transponder Batman had placed on Joker, because he's like, yeah, I wasn't going to just let him out. They use the bat beam to break into the hideout. A bat fight breaks out, during which Robin removes the helmet from Overbeck. It turns out the helmet was actually part of the whole brain-regulating device that Overbeck used to regulate the treatment. His thought patterns were the ones that were supposed to be calming Joker down, but Joker's mind was too powerful, and he overwhelmed Overbeck. And in the course of the treatment, subconsciously, I guess, Joker worked out this plan to get him to escape. I loved it. I thought it was just actually really well done.
I thought it was a little unnecessarily complex. But I also have to admit that I might have been very tired when I read it. Uh-huh. I was very taken with the art in this issue.
Yes.
I love the throwaway gag where Batman and Robin put their miners' lights on their foreheads, and Batman's yes. has a Batman logo and Robin's has a Robin logo, because of course.
Yeah.
I think it looks great. I like how in the end the Red Hood is the Joker, as opposed to being Overbeck, in the sense that he's kind of reprogrammed the helmet with his mind.
Yep.
So you're getting, yes, of course, the Red Hood and the Joker are one and the same. Mm-hmm. There's also kind of a throwaway to the more vicious comic book Joker in the very end. There's kind of a want joke, but you know, it's you when Robin says, you know, what a terrible thing to be loose in the world, this idea of like the madman Joker loose in the world, and the Joker kind of winks at the camera, which sort of seems to be a, you know, how horrible would it be if he were really a bad guy?
Right.
That seems to be kind of the message that I'm getting there. So I think it was fine. Like I said, I think it was great looking. It's not my favorite story of the bunch, but I think there's a lot to like here.
See, I actually got to say, I thought this was one of the better ones of the bunch. The only disappointment I had was it should have been a three-parter. Maybe that's part of the problem was that, you know, when you say the complexity, maybe if they had stretched it out to one more week and made it a full-length issue, the complexity wouldn't have been so complex. Because they had to rush it all in. I know, it
was jammed in, yeah, maybe. Yeah. Or maybe I just, like I said, maybe I was tired when I read it, because I did read it late at night. But I did like overall the mixing of, you know, it does take some getting used to, but you're taking all these different elements of the TV show and the Batman comic world, and you're shaking them together, and I think overall that it works. And, of course, it's great to see Professor Overbeck. Again, he doesn't look like Professor Overbeck right. because he can't, but just the fact that they – this is where I like where Parker was, you know, clearly paying attention to the series in picking up these things, because, yes, of course, Professor Overbeck would be at the Arkham Institute.
Right, exactly. So our little side story, our one-parter here, is called Scrambled Eggs.
And another new appearance by another villain. It's by Jeff Parker, art by Sandy Jarrell, colors by Rico Renzi, letter by Wes Abbott, and we get Egghead.
We get Egghead, but all right. I'll tell you what. Let me read the synopsis here. We'll do it,
sure.
And then let's talk about it here. The story opens with Egghead waxing poetic about eggs. But then we open full to see that the dynamic duo have already been captured, suspended upside down inside a transparent egg. Batman questions Egghead's scruples that he used a charity event to lure the two there and then captures them. The two are released from Egghead's blimp and have to escape before the egg hits the ground. They get free of their bindings and then pop the lid off the egg. With his remote control, Batman sends the Batcopter towards them. They have to time the copter flying alongside them. Robin manages to snag the Batcopter with his batarang, and the two reach the copter, steer it to Egghead's vehicle, which they gain control of by using the steering outside, and then steering it to Gotham Penitentiary. It's a cute little story, and there's some nice little touches, including, because I don't remember if they did this in the TV series, was there ever a mention of Robin's circus days?
No. Again, it's like we've been seeing with mentions of Edward Nigma and, you know, and Oswald Cobblepot and a lot of this stuff. They're mixing the comic world and the TV world, and right. I think it's fine.
Yeah. My biggest quibble, and this is the thing, it's two-part. It's like, wow, the first time we bring Egghead back, and he's only got this little one-part story, and it's basically a Batman and Robin have to get out of a trap story, and it does nothing in the end. Because I say this as someone, and this is my problem with it. I love Egghead. I hated the season three stories. This did nothing to redeem Egghead and bring him back to his glory. And that was a shame. And also, you know, the art was fine. It was serviceable. I just thought, God, Egghead, though, what's with the big nose?
What, John, who did someone mess with your eggs this morning? You seem rather persnickety about this one. I liked it fine. It's a short story. It's a short story, and I like the art just fine. It's here's the thing. When I was mentioning in one of the previous episodes of this journey, as you put it, that we're on now with these comics, there isn't a lot of death trap stuff.
Right.
Because of the way that these stories are paced. And basically what you're getting here is a death trap story.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all that it is. We don't have how they got there. We don't really have, you know, they wrap it up pretty quickly. It's a lot of monologuing by Egghead, which is not like him, at least not to my recollection. I don't think that he really sounds like Egghead, but I really don't care. Really, it's more about the way that they get out of this trap, which is this is the kind of trap they couldn't do on the TV show,
right?
But they keep it in that realm in the way that they make it absolutely impossible to do. And yet the way that you have three or four pages here of them breaking out of the egg and calling in the Batcopter, which looks great.
It does. No,
it is. It looks great. Eugene Knock would be proud. the Batcopter looks terrific. And then this whole back and forth about how they are, as they're falling, they're calculating the rate of gravity and drag and all of this kind of stuff. The whole thing to me just acts as one big gag, and so I think it works fine. The fact that it's not really a fleshed out story, it's a short eight pager. It's all that it is, and right. I'm totally down with it.
And we get, and I'm not complaining about this one way or the other. Egghead goons, they're different this time. They're not wearing the suits.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And you get an expletive deleted, which I think is a nice.
That was a nice touch at the end. Yeah. No, yeah. I'll give you that. But I'm just, I'm hoping that, you know, he'll make a return in this series and again
he does.
He gets redeemed. I'm playing this from the angle of, like, I've never read it, even though I have. I don't remember I don't remember a lot. I mean, I only read through the series once. So this is nice to actually read through it again, talk to you about it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I know he does come back. I don't remember whether the story's good. I do remember he's back. But yeah, I'm the same way. I'm rereading these for the first time since I first read them.
Right. And, of course, the adventure also continues over at 13thdimension.com, where Dan's talking comic books from news, reviews to interviews. It's all there at 13thdimension.com. So that's going to do it then for this episode of the Batcave podcast. Tune in. We're back to Londinium. Now, this is the interesting thing. The advertising does say Londinium. If you get this book on Comicology, it says we're in Londinium. That's all scrapped in the story itself. But
yeah,
you know what?
It is.
I'm fine with it because we're getting Batman and Robin taking on Mad Hatter.
And we'll get to that in our next episode.
So until tomorrow, folks, thank you so much for listening. Once again, Dan, citizens, take care.
Bye.
Thanks for listening, chums. I don't have a bat phone, but you can contact the Batcave Podcast through its Facebook page, Twitter, email at thebatcavepodcast@gmail.com. Subscribe to the podcast via Libsyn.com. That's Libsyn.com. Or through iTunes. The Batcave Podcast is part of a series of pop culture podcasts from the Chronic Rift Network. Find them at chronicrift.com. So until next time, citizens, same bat time, same Batcave Podcast.